Hello, I'm Jen Judson, Land Warfare Reporter for Defense News, and thank you for joining us here for the SMD Debrief. We're coming in live from the Missile Defense Agency headquarters at Fort Belvoir, Virginia. My guest is Laura DeSimone, Executive Director for the Missile Defense Agency. Laura, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Last year, Vice Admiral Hill laid out his top three missile defense priorities: defending the homeland, hypersonic missile defense, and getting the missile defense architecture established in Guam. Are these priorities likely to shift in the coming years in any way? And if not, explain why these remain important. And if you do see the priorities potentially shifting, where do you see things heading?
Well, first again, thank you for having me. I'm excited to talk about the Missile Defense Agency as well as our programs here. Our priorities are driven by a couple of really foundational documents. First of all, the National Defense Strategy, as well as the recently conducted Missile Defense Review, as well as the defense planning guidance that comes down from the department. So those priorities that you outlined right now are carrying forward. As the department, of course, with the changing threat environment, and as the department shifts priorities, then we adjust accordingly. Right now, we are nested and well aligned under those priorities laid out in those documents.
Okay, so explain why these priorities are so important to Missile Defense Agency, how it aligns with the Missile Defense Review and the strategy, starting with defending the homeland, hypersonic missile defense, and getting that architecture on Guam.
Really, the key elements to think about missile defense is to break it out into a couple major mission areas. The first being homeland defense. Homeland defense is our main mission here, and it really is to protect the nation against that rogue nation missile threat, potentially from North Korea or Iran. So the department guidance right now and policy reinforces that as our mission to protect the nation against that threat. And I'm sure we'll get into a little bit later about the elements that make up that system. There's an increased emphasis, though, on the regional defense aspects of what we do here. Again, as the changing threat environment, the department has asked us to take on additional threats in the regional perspective. And so programs like Defense of Guam, like hypersonic defense, those fall under that structure of the regional defense programs. So as laid out, Homeland Defense Program, Next Generation Interceptor, foundational to what we do, and then regional defense programs is really our main two mission areas.
And why is the Missile Defense Agency pursuing hypersonic missile defense now? Talk a little bit about the threat and why this is such a high priority now for the Missile Defense Agency.
Yeah, absolutely. One of the great relationships that we have here at the Missile Defense Agency is with the intelligence community. Do a really great job of collecting information and learning about the development efforts that our adversaries are, embarking on. So, we have seen testing done by some of our adversaries to develop this new class of missile, this hypersonic missile. And it's important because it changes some of the key attributes of how you actually would play defense, right? This is all about making sure that we can play defense against these types of missile threats. And the hypersonic missile challenges the way that we normally would execute a defense engagement. So it's really important that we now are working on systems to enhance our sensing capability against hypersonic missiles, as well as embark on a layered defense approach to actually engage the hypersonic missiles.
Okay, let's hone in a little bit on this top priority of homeland missile defense. So the agency's holding a competition for the next generation interceptor to replace the current interceptors that are in the ground-based mid-course defense system. And Vice Admiral Hill said that he wanted to keep both competitors in through critical design review. Have the competitors passed through preliminary design review yet?
So we're coming up on that milestone here very shortly.
Okay.
for both teams. We've completed the system requirements review. That went very well last year. And by the end of the calendar year, we should have progressed through both competitors' preliminary design reviews.
Okay, so by the end of the year, great. So in terms of the critical design review, are you still expecting to then wrap up by the end of 2024 if you are closing things out in the preliminary design review in 2023? Will they need a year to get to that point?
Actually going to need closer to 2 years.
Okay.
There's a lot of work that happens between these two milestones. Although I'd say that general engineering roadmap for development is changing with the advent of, I mean, both of these programs are fully digital engineering programs, and we're taking advantage of one of the benefits, which is to accelerate coming through the design concepts and the design trades. So, but it is a complex program, a challenging program. So we're expecting the critical design review for both competitors to be in the 2025 timeframe.
Okay. Now, both competitor teams, because of, as you mentioned, the digital designs that they're working on, have been looking to trying to accelerate and have a faster timeline. Based off of where things are now, and the where you think the critical design review will land, do you believe it's likely NGI could come online earlier than planned? I know right now the target is 2028. Is that realistic at this point, or do you see a chance to be a little earlier on that?
Yeah, great question. So the requirement for 2028 emplacement of the first next generation interceptors was really driven by, the warfighter requirement to get new capability emplaced. Both competing and winning bids had acceleration as part of their objective in the program. And we actually, since it's so important to get early emplacement as soon as possible, we incentivized the contract structure to make that a priority. So right now, we're on track for our preliminary design reviews, and I see both competitors being, really having an opportunity to get through the rest of the development cycle and in place early.
Okay, excellent. Often we don't talk about service life extension. It's not as sexy as a new interceptor, but where is MDA in executing the service life extension program for the ground-based mid-course defense system?
Great. So the ground-based interceptors, or the GBIs, they were first in place, the early birds, or as we call them, the early missiles. They were in place in the mid-2000s.
Yeah.
So those early versions, we had an opportunity as we emplaced additional ones to add in additional capability, modernized the vehicles. You could kind of think of a ground-based interceptor as having two major parts, the booster stack, the rocket motor stack, three-stage rocket motor, and then the kinetic warhead that has the kill vehicle and propulsion for the kinetic warhead. So right now in place, we have a couple different flavors, if you will, of GBIs. So because NGI is coming on a little bit later, what we wanted to do was pull the early rounds out of the ground and put them through a service life extension program. So we are right in the middle of that. Actually, re-emplaced, if you will, ones that have gone through an extension program. And what we're doing there is we're actually breaking it apart into those two pieces. We're taking the exo-atmosphere kill vehicle through, replacing some, limited life components and other modernization, software upgrades, et cetera, and then putting them back together and placing them back in their silo. So we're right in the middle of doing that for the early rounds, and we'll continue to do that. The great opportunity that gives us is just like your car, I'd say, the longer you have it, the expected reliability starts to drop down a little bit. So by pulling the early ones out, we're really, and the version that we're putting back in, really increases the reliability and expected performance of that singular missile. So that's a great advantage for the warfighter.